we are worship and pray. Bless somebody, shout hallelujah. God bless you, please be seated. This second part, you see that you don't have the outline, so you write. I don't want to put outline because it will make me spend more time. But when I do something like freestyle, it helps me to look at time and wrap up when I'm to wrap up or around about that time. But the outline somehow is halfway to go, and the tendency is that you already know what's our plan, and I don't want to fold your hand. So when we have been, so even if our plan, people that read what I have even put out in email, or they always discover that I have more plan to minister than I always minister. Always. More. But God will help us in the name of Jesus. I'm going to be talking about dealing with discouragement. Dealing with discouragement. If you are here, you have never been discouraged before, can I please see your holy hand? So that I will come and kneel down before you and you lay hand on me. And let me receive that unction. Praise the Lord. Discouragement is a reality in life. And discouragement does not see anyone or any status that this is a person or a kind of status that I should not go to. The low people, they get discouraged. The very high people, they get discouraged. Sinners, they get discouraged. Righteous people, very right, walking in perfect law of God, the arrow of discouragement gets to them. Even though you may not know, some of the people that we envy and we desire to be like, some of them, sometimes, they eat discouragement, secret frustration in their lives. And some people are discouraged to the point that they commit suicide. Why? Because they don't know how to manage discouragement. Whenever we are ministering like this, we just also know that this is a reality, but how do we deal with it so that whenever we find ourselves in that situation? The high people in the prison of life, they spend discouragement. And sometimes you see somebody looking nice, wearing gorgeous dress, putting on a smile, just to add to the accessories the person has. And the person inwardly can be discouraged. Many people are going to work discouraged because of what a colleague or some colleagues or even the employer or some bosses or even some subordinates are doing. And they seem tied into that situation. Some people are discouraged because of their spouse. Some people, it's because of their children. Some people, their parents. Discouragement is real. Even the people that appear up and doing, like Joseph. When you look at the life of Joseph, it's a life one wants to emulate. Because you see that all through the time that this guy was going through difficulty, he did not really exhibit so much frustration in his attitude. But sometimes those people that are going to discover, they may not really exhibit it. But if you are sensitive, you can sense it sometimes. Joseph that was encouraging other people in the book of Genesis chapter 40, 6 and 7. Genesis 40, 6 and 7. When he saw two guys that were downcast, he came to the prison where they were. He said, cheer up, guys. Why are you feeling down? He was trying to cheer them up. That kind of person, you would think that he is above discouragement. And Joseph came in unto them in the morning and looked upon them, and behold, they were sad. And he asked Pharaoh's officers that were with him in the words of his lost out, saying, "Wherefore look ye so sadly to thee?" He wanted to help them. And somebody like that, you think that this one does not need encouragement. But by the time he sensed that one of them will have a way of helping him, he opened up. He said, "In this place, I've not done anything. No. They have put me into this prison for nothing. Please remember me when you go out." That means that inside of him, he had been feeling injustice for being there. In the book of that, Genesis 40, 15. Genesis 40, verse 15, when he was talking to him. "For indeed, I was stolen away out of the land of the Hebrew." They have never heard him saying something like that. But when he perceived that this guy could help me, he opened up, stolen away out of the land of Hebrew. "And here also have I done nothing that they should put me into the dungeon." Meaning I was not saying it, but within him, said that I was stolen out. My brothers stole me out. And even this woman that lied on me, he was not saying it, but inside was feeling discouraged. And instead, so in the prison of life, discouragement can be. Also in the palaces of life, there could be discouragement. Who could have thought Esther would be discouraged? Esther would be somebody that all the ladies were envy. I wish I could be like this Esther. The queen, the number, the first lady of a nation. They will see the glamour. They will see all the servants, the maid, and people opening the door for her. And they will see her anytime she went out, on and on. But there could be financial discouragement. Sometimes there could also be emotional discouragement. But when Mordecai sent for her and told her to go and tell the king, because they wanted to wipe out her own people, her tribe, she made mention of a secret frustration that people that were envious of her, they did not know of. Esther chapter 4, 11. She sent a message to Mordecai and said that 30 days I've not seen my husband. You mean you are in the palace with your husband and you have no access to your husband because of the position of your husband and the responsibility of the kingdom that he had to handle, and they had to write or because at a particular time they will write and rewrite some of the decrees in the provinces. That was that period. And 30 days counting, though, because he said that at that time, 30 days. But the other ladies that may not have that glamour, they had access to 100% or close to 100% access to their own husband. But she was living in the palace and not having the attention of her husband. The rich also cried. All the king's servants and the people of the king's provinces to know that whosoever, whether man or woman, shall come unto the king into the inner court, who is not called, there is no law of his to put him to death, except such to whom the king shall hold all the golden scepter, that he may live. But I have not been called to come in unto the king. Amen. These 30 days, a full month, see counting. Not that her husband traveled. Not that her husband did not love her. Because there are something, when I read scripture, I'll be able to deduce whether this is it or not. Not that the husband did not, because immediately the husband, she broke the law and she entered. The first thing the husband now did and now stood for the case that, you must not die. What happened? Ask me anything up to the app. So it was not because there are some people, they go through this thing. You envy them, but you may not know what they are going through in their privacy. Based on the responsibility that have been placed on the husband, many people will have access to the husband and it will also affect the one they are married to. But you just envy the outside. Discouragement comes in diverse ways in life. Even the people that are anointed, they will be discouraged. anointing. He had just killed about 850 prophets of Baal. He did not expect that Jezebel would still send a death threat. He expected God. At that time, he actually thought that he was the only one left that was righteous. So he felt lonely. In addition to the fact that he expected God to arise for him, and he felt suicidal. In 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 4. 1 Kings chapter 19, when Jezebel sent the message, he ran away and was not telling God, "Even let me even die there." But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die. And said, "It is enough. Now, O Lord, take away my life. For I am not better than my father." He said a lot of frustration. He was discouraged. Verse 14, he felt lonely. Many of us, sometimes our discouragement has been fueled by the feeling of loneliness. And he said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken their covenant, thrown down their altars, and slain their prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away." Discouragement can come in diverse ways. And many people don't know how to deal with discouragement. When discouragement comes, it leads to worry. And when worry sets in, it leads to absent-mindedness. When a person is absent-minded, you become weary. When you are weary, you become indifferent about situation. And that will lead to backsliding in life. So we should ensure that we don't allow discouragement in our life. I'm praying that every spirit of discouragement that has been sent against any one of us, let the Almighty God terminate it. Let God terminate the reign of that discouragement. In the name of Jesus. The high, the mighty, the low, the poor, the rich, anyone can be discouraged at any point in time. And it is also a weapon in the hand of the devil to get at people, discouragement. In the book of Isaiah chapter 54, verse 17, Isaiah 54, 17, the Bible said that no weapon that is formed against us shall prosper. No weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper, and every tongue that rises against thee in judgment, thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servant of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Discouragement is a weapon. There was a particular woman that was going through so many issues, and she cried, prayed, did vigil, but because of the vigil, she slept off. "But now, why am I going through this? This, my husband is this, my children this," and she now stepped up. In that dream, she saw herself in a very big marketplace. But something that struck her, one store in that market, she saw the inscription "Lucifer's store." In this kind of market, what could that be? And she went just to find out what they will be selling inside Lucifer's store. And she saw so many equipment, armor, chisel, but each of those equipment, they tagged them with names: anxiety, high blood pressure, maybe violence. Then she looked, because she was not looking at the prices of every of these equipment. But there was one that she saw that the price was so much. And she saw it was one hammer. Old! That something be old and be so expensive. And she was now asking herself in her mind, in that dream, And the answer was being spoken out to her hearing. So that the reason is that this armor called discouragement has been used many times and it has always worked. Against the children of God, against anyone, the High and Mighty, air is very expensive in the store. And she woke up. From that particular dream, she just made up her mind, regardless of what she was going to, that she refused to be discouraged and she rose from there. Discouragement is one thing that the devil has been using against people. That the Jew was telling us one time many years ago that he told us of this experience of this. He was in his office and he felt discouraged. He said that all these people that I'm even praying and fasting for, I'm praying and going everywhere, you know, do they really even appreciate? You know, devil, there's a way the devil will start giving you thoughts. Do they really appreciate it that you want to kill yourself because of all these people? That many of them said they are even selfish. The one that even show that they care or that they make want to realize that they care, Daddy, you are stressing yourself too much. Try to relax, so, but Daddy, can you pray for me? You are stressing yourself too much, can you pray for me? That, you know, he was telling up. He said that too. He said that sometimes when he's in, he will be in his prayer room, he will be hearing the prayer, you know, before he comes to the altar. That is sometimes you. You know, he has the TV in this room. Everything that is going on in this room will be seen. Everyone that is ministering will be seen. Just like sometimes I have. Sometimes when you even, then you will hear the prayers that they are praying for him. Father, keep our daddy for us. Let it be well for him for us. I see that. And the devil was not magnifying that in his mind. And do they really care how he feels sometimes? Did they really care about his own physical needs, emotional needs? You know, he said that he just felt discouraged. He was alone. And he now put his head on his table. He just slept. He felt so sad. And he slept. How did you around him? He would not know what was happening. He said that he was just woken up by a knock that somebody said that a little girl has come to see you. I said, okay, let her come in. And the girl, you know, that came, that said that, God spoke to her. She was saying that God spoke to me. She came from VI. Maybe the driver brought her, you know, maybe from the different, that I should bake a cake, a special cake for you. I don't know how to hear from God, but the fact that the voice came to me, it must not be the devil that will tell me to go and give cake to a pastor. So pastor, I brought this cake to me. He said he's not the cake person. But at that point in time, God just spoke to him. Maybe he said, nobody cares for you. That even if you may not be able to see all, people still care for you. He took the cake, blessed the girl, and he said that from that day, his fervency in serving God many, many years ago just rose. So discouragement can get to anyone at any point in time. David, he went through discouraging times. But there was something that God was always telling people that will achieve. Like Joshua, in the book of Joshua chapter 1, 6 and 7. Joshua was about to take over from Moses. Joshua was not really experienced, but God kept on telling him, be of good cheer. And be strong and be of good courage. He kept on telling him, be strong and of a good courage. For unto these people shall thou divide for an inheritance the land, which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. Go to verse 9. If God is repeating something, that means that thing should be very, very important. Verse 9, not 8. Verse 9. Have not I commanded thee? He repeated it again. Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. Discouraged means that they are discouraged. They are removing courage from that person. There are some things that happen in our lives, or happen to us, that you that used to be very full of faith, all of a sudden the faith will just start. That thing is trying to remove courage from you. That is what they call discouraged. And God kept on telling him, be strong and be of good courage. God will not say something that is obvious. Meaning that at that point in time, he was already afraid. He let him to do what Moses could not do. Moses, that we have been looking at, said that the way you can achieve what Moses himself could not achieve. Two things, be strong and be of good courage. And that is still going to everybody today. He's telling you be strong because there are some things that have happened to you or that will be happening to you that will make you to feel weak. He said that, but defy that you're feeling. Be strong and be of good courage. I am with you. God will not say he's with somebody when it is obvious. Many times it's not obvious. Job said, I look to the right, to the left. Job chapter 23, verse 8 and 9. I look to the right, I'm not seeing God though. I look to the left, I cannot see the front. Because all the children dead, all his business, said that where is God now? But God said, I'm still there. Just when you cannot trace me, trust me. Behold, I go forward, but he is not there. And backward, but I cannot perceive him. On the left hand, where he do walk, but I cannot behold him. He hided himself on the right hand, that I cannot see him. Yet, he is there. What of in Judges chapter 6, 12 to 14? Judges 6, 12 to 14. Gideon, he was hiding. That was not courage. But the angel came to him, said that, thou mighty man of valor, the Lord is with you. And he now said something that many of us will also say, if the Lord is with me, how come I'm going through this problem? How come I don't have a job? How come I'm not married? How come I don't have a child? How come I cannot get this visa? I've wasted all my money. How come I don't even have accommodation? How come? He said that don't ever use your problem to determine whether God is with you. He was telling him when all those things were going on, he said that God is with you. He said that just know it. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, the Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor. Was he feeling mighty when he was hiding? And Gideon said unto him, oh my Lord, if the Lord be with us, why then is all this befalling us? Where be all his miracles which our fathers told us of? Saying, did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us. That what he was appearing to him. But the angel was giving him correct information of the spiritual. Said that even in this situation that you are struggling, God is with you. And deliver us into the hand of the Midianite. 14. And the Lord looked upon him. He did not even answer all the things that he was saying. Meaning that all these things that you are saying, even though they are physical, what you are saying, but they are not relevant. Let me say, tell you the gospel truth, the spiritual truth. And the Lord looked upon him and said, go in this thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianite. Have not I sent thee? Courage is the ability to go ahead even when you cannot see your way clear. So far God has told you, just do it. One sister came to us one time and she was just complaining about the thing she was crying. So I'm telling her that, don't worry. You know, with all these problems, there will still come a triumphing in it. Dear Pastor, I'm discouraged. Look at how long. I'm tired. I understand. I think it happens to every one of us. Have you been discouraged? Many times. The only thing that God has now, sometimes you now learn how to rise above your discouragement and you now get on to joy again. I told her of, I think it was that period, some few years ago, I went for a provincial meeting of pastors. We, a particular cadre of pastors, will assess some other lower pastors. So the one above us will assess us. So I did, you know, I saw the assessment, I did the assessment for the one that they told me to do assessment for. I took over five different diligence, vision, so to work. Then, yeah, okay, four over five, you know, five. But I don't did my own assessment to the ones. Then when it was my own time, it had been done anyway in my absence. But somehow the assistant pastor to the province now called me. Have you done your something? Okay, let me even see. Where's your own? I just took out my own. And also what the senior pastor that was told to assess me put there. I think it was 2/5. 2/5. So that, and I don't look at the heading, diligence, 2/5. Ability to move and accept, 2/5. I just saw it, I was discouraged. I went discouraged that day. And somehow, at that point in time, I now left that place, and I now saw the pastor. He now called me, he said, have you seen the assessment? I said, yeah, I just saw it now. So what do you think? I said, well, I think that I should have been assessed better than that. He said, the reason why is that there was a particular program, you know, we're supposed to do it together, but you were so busy with your Kingsway Palace program that we did not fully, we just were involved, you know. Within me, and I said that, what program, out of how many years of consistency, I felt discouraged. But I go for the Holy Spirit that just came. That is the assessment of man. That is not my assessment. And of course, afterwards, God kept on lifting up. He now got to a time we were not doing regional assessment. I think they did that last year. And in the whole region, I think KRP, region means that there are thousands of parishes. KRP came in that consideration. I think KRP came number 10. Number 10. Meaning in our province, we were number 1 or 2. Don't discouragement will come, but refuse to allow it to stick on you. How do we deal with discouragement? Number 1. Before I even start talking about how to deal with discouragement, the technical people, they will play one song for me now that I told them that they will play. That song happened to be one hymn. The hymn. Well, not hymn, it's a song. It's a song. And what brought about that song? That happened to be this couple, Mr. and Mrs. Doolittle. Okay. Mr. and Mrs. Doolittle. And the wife had been bedridden from almost the inception of their marriage, meaning that she was on bed. And the husband, he became crippled. On the wheelchair, he rolled himself to walk. I don't know the kind of work that he was doing. And one day, they were now, if the missionary came to them, they saw that they were encouraging other people. They were doing, people will come, they will be the one encouraging people. They just enjoy, they live their Christian life, they will do many devotion, they will sing praises, they will go to work, roll on the wheelchair to work nearby, come back, and kept on like that. The missionary now came. What is the secret of this, your great encouragement? You are like one encouraging other people. People, when they met, they needed encouragement, they will be coming to your house. How come? And we can, sorry to say, we can see your situation. And Mrs. Doolittle said something. Just a phrase in the Bible. Said that his eye is on the sparrow. And we know he watches us. That was how that missionary took that faith and now brought for that son. Even when you are going through a situation that seems so terrible, just know that God is with you and he can turn around that situation. Can you call that song quick? Is there? Now, how do you deal with discouragement? Number one, go to God in prayer. Go to God in prayer. In the book of Psalm 3, 1 to 4. Psalm 3, 1 to 4. The psalmist was saying there that even though trouble had encompassed around about him and they are asking where is God, he will cry unto the Lord and the Lord will hear him. Lord, how are they increased that trouble me? Many are they that rise up against me. Many there be which stay of my soul. There is no help for him in God's love. But thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory and the lifter of my head. For I cry unto the Lord with my voice. And what happened? And you don't need to see him to cry unto him. God, I cannot see you. Job was saying that I cannot see you on the right leg, but he cried unto him. Just know that God is not deaf. He that created ears, we did not hear. Tell him about that situation instead of just worrying unnecessarily. Number two, go to some people or some places that you know you will find encouragement. Go to some people that don't believe you are, or places, the atmosphere of encouragement is the atmosphere of change. In the book of Psalm 61, verse 3, Psalm 61, verse 3, David said that whenever his heart happened to be overwhelmed, let God lead him to the rock. That rock that is higher than you. Sometimes it could be God, sometimes it could be somebody with higher unction that can pray for you, counsel you, and take you up out of that valley. Psalm, is it Psalm 61? Okay, give me from one. But it says that wherever my heart is overwhelmed, hear my prayer, O God, attend unto my prayer. Okay, verse 2. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, that is not discouraged, lead me to somebody else, a place where I can find comfort or courage again. Then number 3. No, this one is what you know. No, that no situation can hold you down until you agree with it totally. No situation can hold, even bad situation can be turned around in your favor. That knowledge will keep you encouraged. In the book of Romans chapter 8, 28. Romans chapter 8, 28. Remember that for how many things work together? All things. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and to them that are the called according to his will. Can you give me verse 31? Verse 31. Know that if God is for you, what shall we then say to this thing? If God be for us, who can be against us? When you go further to 35, 37, you will see the talk about different perils, different danger, different, that in all these things we are more than. Have the knowledge of that. Let it be solid in your heart. Then number 4. Try to remember God's goodness, whether the past or the present. Because one thing about discouragement is that it will blind your eyes so many good things that God has done and what God is doing. And it will just magnify the ones that he has not done. Few ones that he has not done. And that one will now take over. Learn. That's why in the book of Psalm 103, 2 to 5. Psalm 103, 2 to 5. David also felt discouraged, but he taught us the secret. He said, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Forget not all his what? Benefits. He now started counting the thing for his soul. Who forgiveth all thy iniquities? Who healed all thy diseases? Can you count the number of times that you have been sick, you have been blessed, you have gone to the hospital? Who have been healing you? Who redeemed their life from destruction? Who crowned thee with loving kindness and tender mercy? Who satisfied their mouth with good things so that their youth is renewed like the eagle? Remember, there is this hymn that I love, and it has to do with remembering God's goodness, counting your blessings, name them one by one. When upon life billows, you are tempted, tossed, tempted, as if you are in the stream. Can you give us that hymn? When upon, we just read through the hymn. He said, I count your blessing. Okay, let's sing it briefly. When upon life below you are tempted, tossed. When you are discouraged, thinking of his love. Count your many blessings, name them one by one. And it will surprise.